Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are getting into the big issue, and certainly we have two subjects of discussion. The first one is fighting is still going on in Sudan, and we want to look at the problem in Sudan and how best can be resolved, but also the incident of the Minister of State in charge of Labour and Industrial Relations, the Honourable Charles Okello Engola, who was yesterday gunned down by a private UPDF officer, also one of his guards. We want to have a conversation about what exactly does this mean, but also we've had our witnesses coming out to say this gentleman came out to tell them that he had no problem with them, but certainly some of them concluded that he might have been going through mental challenges. And certainly we want to have that conversation, how to deal with mental health challenges within our forces. I'm with Agatha Mohaise, who we have been actually moving together in this whole conversation, but now we are joined by Major David Rusa, former Operations Director at the Internal Security Organization. Yes, retired, major retired. You're no longer a serving officer. I have to be very strict with that. Major, thank you so much for joining us again. And I want to start with a question of Sudan. We have seen since April 15th, there has been infighting going on. Why do you think it is taking this long to have a lasting solution and a ceasefire that can as well stand for a lasting solution in the problems that we are seeing in Sudan?
Well, the issue of Sudan is a very intricate one, because I always like to analyze from history. Sudan got independence in 1956. Mm. That's what we didn't talk about last time, because it was waste. And since that time, Sudan has never known peace. Immediately, or towards independence.
What do you mean? But it has never known peace.
It has never known peace.
It has not been at war. No, Bashir has been in power for quite some time.
I'm going to explain. You know, peace is not the absence of war. Well, in 1956, those people who, the Africans, okay, call them that, Southern Sudanese, were opposed to the Arab rule. And I think they were maybe trying to have a situation like that of India, where India on independence was divided into two countries. 1947, India became two countries, India and Pakistan. And then Pakistan was a funny situation, because the eastern part and the west were divided by India still, which later on caused the secession of the east from the west to form a new state called Bangladesh. Mm-hmm. Now, in the case of India, the reasons why it was partitioned that way was because of religion. Hindus, Buddhists on one hand, and then Muslims on the other. And so Pakistan, east and west, were Muslim, while India remained a Hindu state. It is. Well, Sudan, I think, because Sudan got independent almost in the aftermath of India's independence, because India got independent in 1947, and Sudan, 55, 56, got independent. Now, the Africans decided to fight, and they called themselves Anyanyas. I'm told in one of their languages, Anyanya means venomous snake. Mm. So they fought on from 1956 to 1972. Now, somewhere along the way, Uganda was sucked into the war, especially with Idi Amin. Idi Amin had gone to Israel and done a course which he didn't complete for reasons I don't know, maybe academic. But the Israelis came in to help South Sudan, 1969 to be precise, with military equipment and hardware. You may ask why. the Israelis thought or believed strongly that if South Sudan broke off from Sudan, or if Sudan was hit from the south, it would be weakened and it would not be in position to support their fellow Arabs in Syria and Egypt who are fighting Israel. And so in 1969, Amin and Uganda acted as conduit, taking arms to Sudan. And Amin was very comfortable with that. As a matter of fact, it is strongly believed that one of the reasons why Milton Obote was overthrown in 1971 was because he had come too close to Jafar Numeri and was trying to stop aid to Sudan. So the Israelis, in cohorts with Idi Amin, decided to remove Milton Obote when he was in Singapore attending the Commonwealth Heads of Government Conference, 1971. Now, Amin's love affair with the Israelis didn't last long. Remember, when Obote was overthrown, he ran to Tanzania. And so Amin, he was, of course, he was simplistic in his outlook. And he wanted Israel to help him, give him jet fighters to bomb Tanzania. And Israel didn't agree to this. They refused. Now, because Israel refused, Amin took offense. And in 1972, I think March, I don't remember the exact month, Amin decided to get rid of the Israelis. But of course, there were also promises of money from the Arab world, in particular Libya. Libya promised him financial aid and even arms. So Amin got excited. But then, funny enough, after Amin had sent away Israel, those arms didn't come. Maybe some of the money came, but and that's why it's so. So, because South Sudan had lost logistical support from Israel, since they had been chased from Uganda, they could no longer send their arms to Sudan via Uganda. And so, inevitably, the South Sudanese Anyanya fighters were forced to talk peace. Of course, with Amin trying to cajole them, and then with them, eventually they had peace discussions and even signed a peace accord in Ethiopia in 1972, where Numeri signed for Sudan and General Joseph Lagu signed for the Anyanya movement. So, remember I said Sudan has never known peace. So there was a lot of optimism that there would be peace, but it was short-lived, very short-lived. You see, what brings about that? Somehow, those people call themselves Arabs. I told you these are Arabized, really.
Somehow, even when they are racially black.
Racially black. Somehow, they do not want to treat those they call Africans as equals. And Africans are not willing to play second fiddle to those Arabs. This is our land. This is Africa. Even the word Sudan, as I told you last time, was a derogatory term by the Arabs themselves, meaning land of the blacks. So now the issue is, how did land of the blacks all of a sudden change to land of the Arabs? See? So soon there was a resumption of war. And there were some young men, enlightened, who joined that struggle. One of them was John Garang, who was a student, had been to Dar es Salaam and the United States. And so when they were absorbing the fighters, Garang was absorbed as one of the Sudanese soldiers. And he was promoted to the rank of colonel. 1983, the war was getting tough. And remember, there was even a protracted war in Uganda. So another war is in Sudan. So look at that, the coincidence. So in 1983, the Sudanese government sent Colonel Garang to go to the south and quell that rebellion. And Garang went as an officer. Now, instead of Garang going to quell the rebellion, he ignited the rebellion. He organized the SP, he even changed the name from Manyanya because it was meaningless.
Yeah.
I told you it meant venomous snake. Now he said, no, 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 we need to have a political movement. Garang's philosophy was very akin to Museveni's, that you cannot fight without a political wing.
Yes.
So any struggle without a political wing is devoid of anything and cannot bear fruit. So Garang formed
and it should be the vice versa.
Yeah.
Any struggle with without a military wing.
Okay. No, 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 no. So what Garang did, he formed the Sudan People's Liberation Movement with its army, the Sudan People's Liberation Army. And so began the real liberation war. Garang, since he had been in the military, he organized the SPLA forces according to the standard military formations, divisions, brigades, battalions, companies, down.
But he was loyal to the Khartoum military.
No. I have told you he defected.
He defected, but certainly he was still in operation.
No.
Although he acted Mubarak, differently.
When he went, you cannot eat your cake and have it, can you? When he went, he decided to organize the rebels. And even declared, declared that he was no longer in the employ of the Sudanese government, that he was now a rebel leader in southern Sudan in his own right. And so began a war. And remember, this is the time when Garang's great buddy and friend, Yoweri Museveni, was fighting in the jungles of Uganda. So you see how these two allies, and of course, the example of Museveni and the way he was performing against the Ugandan government acted as a very big encouragement to John Garang. And so the war raged from 1983. And as luck would have it, in 1986, Garang's erstwhile ally, Yoweri Museveni, captured power in Uganda. So, you know, there's a saying in Luganda. I know you people are not fluent in Luganda. Chetwayagalize mbazi.
Hey, that one. Chibuyaga food.
Okay.
Chibuyaga agude, not asude.
Agude asude.
Asude, oh. Yeah, yes, maybe.
So, that, in other words, what we wanted the axe for has now been felled by wind. And so what Garang, the help that Garang needed came in handy with a friendly government in Uganda.
How did that weaken the Sudanese Khartoum government?
Okay, we are getting there. So because of Uganda down south, some help, because now these are old open story. Because Uganda had already achieved liberation, Museveni continued clandestinely to send support to his old friend and pal, which enabled Garang to engage the Khartoum government, and not without a cost for Uganda, because Sudan, in retaliation, decided to arm and support Ugandan dissidents.
LRA.
Before that, even with the Odongla Tech, UPDA, and then I don't think they supported Lakwena, and then, of course, Konyi, and the Konyi war really wreaked havoc in northern both in northern Uganda and southern Sudan. And remember, southern Sudan was still a part of Sudan.
Yes.
So what affected southern Sudan, obviously, affected the Sudanese state. And war raged on. Several battles were fought. Sometimes towns like Tolit changed hands between the rebels.
Is there now a need to re-establish a new Sudanese state? Because what we are seeing, the evacuations we are seeing, foreign nationals are all leaving. And it seems like Sudan is at a collapse, at a verge of a collapse, either to a state of Syria or Yemen or even Somalia. Do you agree with this kind of thing?
No, I wouldn't. Why wouldn't I? Because these Sudanese generals, at least both of them have been conventional soldiers, even rapid support forces. Hamdan Hamdit has trained as, he's now a professional soldier, you might say. And then the Sudanese government, they are professionals who have, and remember, Sudan even has a very good military academy at Omdurman. And some of their forces train there in other countries too. Like Nimer even trained in the United States. Even all these people have trained in various countries. And so because of that, and then that aside, the Sudanese state, like I told you last time, it has got quite good infrastructure, although they have been tampering with it now. I told you Khartoum as a city is very big. In fact, almost twice as big as Nairobi and Kampala put together. And then don't forget the strong Arab culture. The Sudanese people have actually been involved in fights for liberation. First, fought against Egypt, which tried to colonize them at the time of the Ottoman Turkish Empire. You know, some of these people came here as explorers. Samuel Baker, Charles Gordon, Emin Pasha were employed by the Anglo-Egyptian Sudan. Right from all that long. And it took a very long time for Egypt to conquer Sudan, which they eventually did, with the help of the British in 1820. But since then, the Sudanese have been struggling against colonialism and imperialism. And you remember, I don't know whether you have ever heard of the Mahdi Rebellion, I think around 1890-something, which forced the British and Egyptians to rethink the occupation of Sudan. Well, now, after the independence of Sudan, like I said, in 1956, because of the intransigence of the Arab Sudanese, because of their arrogance, their inability to accept that their country had two groups of people. Sudan has enjoyed, had a long period of instability.
But Rusa, who do you think is going to help Sudan get peace? Because if you're to look at it, we have seen several organizations coming up to send people to broker some peace. We have seen IGAD sending Salva Kiir, who had his own fighting in his country. We have seen UN trying to broker a ceasefire that are failing each week.
I want to correct you. As a matter of fact, I've just seen something from the president of South Sudan where they have agreed to a one-week ceasefire. 1 week ceasefire, after which they will begin to talk peace.
But we've seen three ceasefires fail.
Well, you see, you never stop trying. Well, this is under the aegis of IGAD, Intergovernmental Authority on Development. Remember last time I told you that the solution to the Sudanese conflict will not come, even not even from the UN. It will not come from the EU. It will not come from the US. It will not come even from Russia or China. Solution will come from Africa. I am seeing two things here. The AU and IGAD, those two. Of course, there will always be violations of ceasefire. You expect that.
Yeah.
But a time will come when these people have got to come together. These, I mean, like I said last time, these are citizens of the same country. And okay, because they want always to use race. Or they are both Arabs. Brian is an Arab.
Yes.
And
Hamid.
Hamid is an
Arab.
So that alone, we expect at a certain point in time, some of these Arab countries which have taken sides, like the Emirates and Saudi Arabia, will eventually see sense and come in also. But support the efforts of the AU. I can see that happening. Of course, they may support with money. They may not have the troops, but they could support with money.
But between the Arab world, the superpowers, and Africa, yes, you have said Africa is in the best position. Who do you think is best situated to mediate this conflict?
Obviously, Africa. Obviously, why do I say Africa?
Why do you underplay the role of
the superpowers?
The superpowers.
The superpowers. I told you last time that I'm yet to be convinced. In fact, I've got some friends, at least who are in the know about the US. And none of them acknowledges, and they are really placed, you could say. None of them acknowledges that the US has. Okay, sympathies. You know, it's one thing to sympathize with you when you are in trouble. Maybe the US might sympathize with you. I even don't know, because after we had talked here, the information I got is that the US might after all be supporting Burhan, not
Hamid.
Hamid. Okay? Then we have the this group which you love most, Wagner Group. The Wagner Group. You see, it is all a confused situation. Because these were one people yesterday.
And so now today they are speaking
different. Some people were supporting both Wagner and, rather, Wagner was supporting both Hamdi and Burhan. Now they have fallen apart. So these people might be trying to find their way. How do they realign? But it's not easy, because a situation like this, even the population have what they say. What do the population think, the Sudanese people? Because Hamdan comes from Darfur. He's a Darfur Arab. But then he did a lot of funny things in Darfur.
He's not as popular.
He's not popular in Darfur. On the other hand, Burhan is not unpopular anywhere. He's not popular anywhere, and he's not unpopular. So maybe it is easier for him to be accepted even in Darfur and Kordofan. Now, that aside, Burhan is currently the head of state. So he's got the instruments of power. You know, these instruments, don't think they are useless. The moment you have the national emblem, you have the flag, you have State House, you are labeled Commanding Chief of the Armed Forces, and you are called Chief Executive, it means legally you are
the head of state.
Yes, the head of state. You are the representative of the nation, both de facto and de jure. Nobody can doubt that.
Absolutely. Major David Rusa, and of course we want to conclude that conversation. I want to take a short break. When we return,
I want to come back home to the events. I know for sure you know Charles Okello Engola, who yes. was gunned down. We want to find out what you think about him and what the events that, you know, the memories that you shared with him, but also we talk about mental health in our military and security services. We're taking a break. We are coming back with that and much more. Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We are discussing two subjects. Now we come back to home, and we want to find out exactly Major's take on the incidents that we saw yesterday. Agatha, you were at the crime scene, and you saw what exactly happened in Chanja.
Yes.
You spoke to the communities, and certainly the people who were around, eyewitnesses. What was evident in there?
It was a sad mood, like I told you earlier, and the communities seemed like they had lost a person who was a good neighbor to them.
Mm.
Yes, and that is something I would like to question Rusa about. I bet you met Charles Engola in the corridors of
power.
Of power. In
Rusa has been around the corridors of power
yes,
for quite some time.
apparently, I'm a very frank man.
Mm. Mm.
I had ever seen Colonel Charles Engola, and that's where it stopped. We greeted, okay, hello, hello. And, but that's where it stopped. I didn't know him personally.
Mm.
And maybe that makes my discussion better, because I don't have any personal feelings for or against him. But I think we need to look at the principle here. First and foremost, Colonel Engola was a very good commander who fought for, you know, he was even involved in fighting in the Konyo War.
Mm.
LRA.
He was really a very good commander. He fought valiantly, and then after that, he became a political leader, starting with the district chairman, until when he went to parliament and was appointed a minister by the president. Of course, it's a very sad moment when we lose a leader of his caliber. And at the hands of, well, I don't want to call God's people useless, but at the hands of somebody who even might not have known why he was doing whatever he did.
Mm.
Because what I read, the bad thing, that man is now no more.
Mm.
I wish he had lived on to tell us why he did what he did.
Mm.
But since he's not around, we shall only speculate.
Mm.
I hear those people, I think when you went there, I hear he told them he had not been paid for months.
Mm. Yet he had only worked for 1 month.
Let's even say he had not been paid for months.
Mm.
The question is it the minister who pays his escorts?
No.
The answer is obviously no. That is number one.
Mm.
Number two,
mm.
when you shoot your principal, does his dead body produce money to pay you? See?
Absolutely no. Mm.
So, and then, what is that anger, that hate, which causes you to kill? That, you know, that man was a real big man.
Mm.
Big in size, don't talk about big. Somebody you would even hesitate to face head on.
Mm.
And I didn't know of any controversies that he was involved in.
True.
We have been having the
Mabati
issue. I don't think he featured anywhere.
Yeah.
He didn't. He has been a simple, good servant. And like a good UPDF officer. You know, UPDF officers are humble people, many of them.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
They do their job. They are not assuming. They let their actions speak more than their words.
Mm.
Mm. And I think this is what Colonel Charles Angola was.
While investigations are still underway and we are still not certain about what could have transpired or what could have dictated what Private Sabiti did yesterday, there have been allegations that this could have been a mental health challenge. You have served in the army before, you have seen the conditions there. Do you think us improving the welfare of these security officials would avoid such incidents?
Well, I do not think the UPDF or any other security organ, police, prisons, I don't think they are the most deprived people in this country. I don't think so. Because if you look at the pay they get, they earn more than many government workers, by the way. And their pay is always on time. So this business of saying that he had not been paid, and it doesn't hold. It doesn't hold. Of course, even if it was true, you don't kill. You know, this, your principle is you are just sent to go and guard somebody. And if you have a good understanding, he can give you some little money for upkeep and so on. So they do, they do. But it's not a must, because you earn. And apart from earning, you are also given some allowance. Those escorts get some allowance. Of course, it may be little. But who gets a lot of money? I don't know whether you get a lot yourself.
No.
Now, let's go to the principle. Let's assume even that the late Colonel
Charles Angola.
Angola was a cruel man. Must cruel people be killed?
Yeah.
How many cruel people do we live with in our community? Okay, that is one. Number two, what wrong did he do to this man? What cognizable wrong did he do to this man to say, anyway, maybe this man was truly provoked? So what is the evidence that Sabiti was truly provoked to the extent of killing this minister? What? I don't get it. What kind of provocation was there? And then there's, I don't know how far true this assertion is, that he had been there for just 1 month.
Yeah, it was, I think, coined by Amongi, the Minister of Gender, who said he had just been transferred from Bombo just a month ago, and he had been with him for...
Okay, from Bombo to be the escort of not only a minister, but a senior UPDF officer, a colonel. And they had a UPDF officer who was involved in a lot of military activities, who eventually joined politics. And by the way, lest we forget, until 21, he was the Minister of State for Defense. He just moved to
gender.
Yes.
So perhaps if he was still in defense, I would have said maybe he wanted him to help him, and he did it. But here is a fellow in gender who left defense long ago. So I just don't understand it. However, like you say, I think what needs to be taken into very strong consideration is that before any soldier is deployed as an escort of somebody, a VIP, that soldier must be vetted, must be strongly vetted, should look at his record, look at his background, observe him carefully. Has he ever been involved in crime? You know, right from when he joined the forces. Because if we don't do that, we are breeding a tiger here. Tomorrow another person can do that.
Do you think our forces take unattached importance to mental health issues of the officers, of men and women in the uniform? Because a
according to eyewitnesses, we seem to have, the man has been going through different challenges, and certainly this is also reflected in the working environments these guys actually live in. Their housing is really terrible, and we have seen this happening, especially with the Uganda Police Force and other
security agencies. Well, Uganda Police Force, I'll not comment much, but when it comes to UPDF, truly, the challenge of bad accommodation, I think, is now history. I think you people, at least, were old to know what they used to call Mama Ingia Pole, these huts where you had to crawl in there. But UPDF now has, I think, the best accommodation of all the government workers. Actually, UPDF should be commended because accommodation has greatly improved. And remember, UPDF has an engineering
brigade.
And that engineering brigade, one of its major duties is construction of accommodation for UPDF personnel. So the issue of
poor working conditions,
and in any case, recently, the pay of UPDF was increased. But of course, pay cannot be increased beyond what the government can afford.
Sure.
This is a poor country, we must accept. It's a poor country, it's a third world country, and we have failed to work to make it better. Middle income country, we are talking about it, but I don't know how many of us are working towards that. You people in the media, I don't know how much you have contributed towards making Uganda a middle income country. But of course, in other countries, how do governments make money? Governments make money from investment. Investments, foreign and local, yes. Governments make money from maybe tourists who come to visit our country. Governments make money through other businesses they engage in, through mining. And Uganda is a very blessed country. I'm told we have got quite a sizable amount of gold. I don't know how much. There has been a dispute. Some people are saying our gold was worth, was it $16 trillion? Others said, no, it's the Chinese didn't understand the language and the conversion. It's not as much as that. But whatever it is, we can say Uganda has minerals, even uranium, by the way. Uganda has uranium.
Yeah. Isn't this caused by the gap between the rich and the poor? You're having an officer who is earning below less than 500,000. Is guarding a minister who is earning 40 million Uganda shillings and above.
Yes. Well, that's not an issue of UPDF, by the way. I don't think that's the problem of UPDF. This is a problem of having a parliament of people who only think about themselves. Truly. Because how much does an MP earn?
On average, about 30.
About 30 million. And how much does a security officer get?
Below 500,000.
About 400.
Okay. Now, if you are an MP, a nationalist, when you are awarding yourself such heavy salaries, do you stop to think that these poor fellows should also be have their emoluments increased? They don't. And in Parliament, I've always noticed, there is one issue where all our MPs are agreed. It is remuneration. When you talk of remuneration, all the vocal opposition MPs become mum. Am I lying?
No, you're not.
So, this selfishness in this country, you know, sometimes you see people, every abuse goes to the president. Well, because he's the chief executive. But surely, the president is not a member of parliament. Parliament is headed by the speaker and the deputy speaker. until the MPs who pass the budget, who lay out all these emoluments of the different categories of people. But all the abuse will always go to President Museveni. You know, in my language, we have a saying that a goat being slaughtered will always look at the person who is holding the leg rather than the man who is cutting the neck, which is very interesting. And this is what we have here. Surely, what has Parliament done to address these gross salary inequalities? What is Parliament, truly? The PS cannot, much as he's the chief accounting officer, he cannot apportion money which is not passed by Parliament.
Where does this leave the other officers, senior government officials, who are actually being guarded by these poorly remunerated officers?
Well, they will continue to guard them. What some other officers do, they use the local approach. When the man has, maybe his child is sick, you give him some little money. His wife has given birth, you help. His mother is sick, you help. That's how they have been doing it. But, of course, we cannot continue to live in haphazard ways of doing things. We need to have a clear, streamlined salary, maybe salary review. But to me, the one institution which bears the greatest responsibility ultimately is Parliament. Ultimately, because it's Parliament which passes the money. Of course, and the fact that they are always agreed when they are passing their own salaries means that they are in, they, really there is a connivance here. There's a connivance to get us. In fact, recently they even wanted to increase their pay.
Yeah, that's true.
I think the president.
But Major, we have to wind up this conversation in a minute.
Yes.
Do you have any issue with the timing of the killing of the minister, right from
Labour Day celebrations,
and also bearing in mind that his predecessor was removed from that ministry, not in a good way.
Who was there, by the way?
Herbert Kawafunzachi.
Well, what did Herbert do? Because I remember there was some.
There was, he was, I think, caught on camera receiving a bribe of 5 million shillings.
I do not see a connection here, truly. I do not see a connection.
And the timing?
Even the timing is, I doubt. You see, this conspiracy theory, our country is a country of conspiracy theories. You know, idle people are very good at conspiracy theory. Now, I heard there's another conspiracy theory, which I want you to look at. It's Sabit who has killed. And Sabit has killed Ongola. So this must now be
a tribal.
A northern, this is all, it's terrible. It is madness. Madness.
All right. Thank you so much, Major David Rusa, for actually those wonderful insights. Thank you so much, Agatha, for moving together. And of course, we want to take a short break. When we return, we want to look at Nansana Municipality. It's one of the most, it's one of the, actually the crime hotspots in this country. We want to sit down with the district resident commissioner of that area to speak about why is this so and what interventions is government doing to address such challenges. A very good morning.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.